So I continue the tradition of celebrating my birthday in Tallinn at SciCon, always fun, and somehow this has just become what I do now, which is a privilege. So thank you so much, Claire, and thank you to the, I don't see any of them right now, but the conference organizers. Thanks for putting on a great show yet again, year after year, and thank you very much for having me back. I've missed Tallinn a lot, and it's good to be home. So we have the title of today's panel up on the wall here, Future Foresight, Visions of Cyberspace Methodologies and Applications. That's a pretty lofty title and a big picture we get to color in. The conference organizers also gave this panel a Niels Bohr quote as a springboard to launch us into this uncertain vista of the future of the cyber domain. I think and I hope the panelists today both appreciate the freedom that this gives them and appreciate the challenge that innately comes with it as well. I hope anyway, we'll see as the session progresses.
As long as we stick to 8 minutes.
Right, I'm gonna be strict. I got my sparkly pen. Before I introduce our eminent panelists, I'm gonna explain a little bit how this session is going to work. And a slight break from SciCon tradition, which I can say, as I've already been described as a SciCon veteran, today's panel is not actually based on any papers. So each of the experts we've invited to come speak today are here to share both their experience from their work and their visions for the future. Hopefully this will also give you some tools and inspire you in the work you do every day. So in order to make your own best predictions, these panelists are going to be presenting both some theoretical models as well as sharing experiences from their own work, to get it more on a tangible level. So we're going to give each of the panelists a few minutes to present their perspectives and experiences uninterruptedly, I should add. And then once they've provided this food for thought for all of you, I'm going to open the panel up to discuss both with each other, but also with you, the audience. I will attempt to resist the temptation to pull on the moderator's prerogative and ask you all my questions, and instead pass the opportunity on to all of you. The aim is to develop an organic conversation, as I've taken to calling it, between you, you, the audience, and the panelists. This is a relatively small room. It's SciCon. You can take your jacket off and relax. This is supposed to be a comfortable environment. So I encourage you all to participate. To that end, we have set up a little Mentimeter for you. You have a quite out there statement on the slide here. We're going to take a little poll at the beginning of the panel, so you can vote while I introduce the panelists. If you log in with this code up here, you will get either or type approach to answering this question, and we'll see if the panelists or indeed the conversation with all of you will change your view on this as the day progresses. Also, in the interest of fairness, because I'm about to introduce these guys, if you do feel called to the microphone, I ask you to please introduce yourselves. Affiliation and name was appreciated. Now, in actual SciCon tradition, today's panelists represent academia, private sector, government, and the military. So it's a great combination of participants that the conference organizers have put together for us. Thank you all for taking the time to travel to Tallinn, participate in the conference, and share your views and your thoughts. On my right, let's see, lost my cheat sheet, that's not good. On my right, I have Herb Lin, who's a senior research scholar at Stanford University's Center for International Security and Security and Cooperation, and the Hank J. Holland Fellow at the Hoover Institution, both at Stanford University. His extensive experience in cybersecurity policy and research includes serving on President Obama's Cybersecurity Commission and the Aspen Commission on Information Disorder. Great title. His research and publications today focus on cybersecurity and national security issues, and his decades of experience provides institutional memory to a field that is in rapid development. On his right, we have Giacomo Paoli, who's the head of security and technology of the Security and Technology Program at the United Nations Institute for Disarmament Research. His expertise includes the implications of emerging technologies for security and defense, and his work at the Institute contributes to the policy discussions that we have today on technology and arms control. His background includes directing RAND Europe's defense, security, and infrastructure research, as well as 15 years as a naval warfare officer in the Italian Navy. Next to him again, we have Chris Fall, who is the Vice President for Applied Science at the Meteor Corporation. With extensive experience from both government and private sectors on matters including energy security and emerging technologies, Chris leads initiatives that drive innovation and apply cutting-edge research to solve complex problems. His background includes director roles at the U.S. Department of Energy as well as ARPA Energy. Chris provides an essential bridge of understanding between government and private sectors. And to the far end of the panel here, we have Ludovic Chocker, who serves as the deputy to the French Junior Minister of Armament, where he's responsible for strategic foresight and emerging technologies. From 2017 to 2022, he provided defense and security advice to the French president, leveraging his experience in national security. His insights in international defense and cooperation and technology innovation makes him an important voice in French work on contemporary defense challenges, which in turn provides this panel with a very practical hands-on contributor. So again, thank you all for making the trip. And with that, again, all of you, get on Mentimeter here. And Herb, the floor is yours.
Okay, so I need my cheat sheet, which is my
PowerPoint. So we have a slide for the first speaker. Please. I see some votes happening, that's good, but we still need the slide so we can start.
So here we see one of the essential problems of technology, right? If you've been on a Zoom call, you know that after 3 years of Zooming because of COVID and so on, you still can't share your slides seamlessly. You still can't unmute yourself and so on properly. All of you have had this experience, right? Everyone in this room has had that experience, and this is the promise of technology. And this is a hard thing to wrap your head around. So I'm getting something. I get my cheat sheet here, but you don't. Thank you.
Yeah.
This is the manual operation.
I have a pen and paper. So, that works really well, I must say.
Yes, I understand. I hope my
there we go.
Now.
No,
thank you.
Start
you.
Now.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for doing the in-between session banter.
I appreciate that. Okay. So what I want to point out here is the increasing complexity in the digital ecosystem around the world. And start out with, many of us started off in cybersecurity, and it was in a very, very limited way. This is how you protect computers. Okay, prevent computers from hacking. I'm a former hacker, protecting computers from people like me. That was a hard enough problem. But then people started to think about, well, in this global environment, how can you start attacking computers? Not just by the bad guys, but by the good guys. That is, offensive operations in cyberspace is an instrument of national policy, deliberate instrument. That in itself was controversial, but there's burgeoning work in that, probably starting 2005 onward, 2010, and so on. Okay, so then you have that. Then you have to think about security of cyberspace, which is somewhat different. It's no longer just the security of the computers, offensively. Now you have to worry about information operations. All the cybersecurity problems haven't gone away, but now you have to include also information operations, misinformation, and so on, conveyed through cyberspace, and that's a big deal. And now in this digital ecosystem, now you have to worry about AI and autonomy. We had several panels on this year. We'll have more next year. So the space that we have to consider is growing. Change in the global environment. More nations play in cyberspace. There are many non-national actors that are very, very important, especially private sector companies. We've heard a number of sessions today about that. The sponsors of this conference are private sector. Okay, we're here partly because of them. Okay, and we also see in this new environment blurring between foreign and domestic actors. Changes in the global political environment. the global rules-based order as globally is under great stress. It may not last much longer. It's really hard to come up with meaningful cyber policy, cybersecurity agreements, cyber treaties, and so on. Yes, I'm fully aware of GGE and open-ended working group efforts and so on. It's very hard to come up with those agreements and ask yourselves, how can they be enforced? Once upon a time, we saw the internet and information technology as the source of goodness in the world. That was the first quote that we saw. Okay. Information technology was going to lead to the kumbaya moment in world affairs, connecting everybody for purposes of good. Well, guess what? The internet and so on connects you to bad people too. And in an environment where you have a lot of sheep and a few lions, it's going to be interesting to see where that comes out. We now see that the impact of information technology can have a downside, at least comparable in importance to the upside. That's a sobering thought. I mentioned the private sector earlier. How do we engage the private sector? How do governments engage the private sector, which both creates the technologies and operates them? Okay. Different nations have different approaches to dealing with this. How does international law apply to private sector corporations? As far as I can tell, that's a very, very dicey place to be, and no one actually knows the answer to that. We also face a lot of increasing technological complexity in this. Okay, there's high heterogeneity in the devices that we use to access the net, the different access mechanisms. Almost everybody in here has their cell phone. Right now, it has computational power far beyond what it was available 20 years ago, and it's in our pockets now all the time. What are the implications of always-on technology, which when it buzzes, when it has something to say to you? Okay. So much so that we now have to turn off the notifications. To keep ourselves from being inundated with them. There's also a proliferation of end-user services. That is, you see more and more and more applications on the internet, applications for everything that you might possibly want it to do. And it's not just you. It's also the bad guys. The bad guys can take advantage of these things. So, for example, in the 2016 election, and probably in the United States, and probably will be true in the 2020 election, will be true this year again. The bad guys have not hacked the computer systems per se, the social media companies and so on. Right? They use those facilities, those end user services, exactly as they were intended to be used. Okay? To bring people together, the wrong people together to be sure, but to bring people together. To create little groups that squabble with each other, to destroy the national cohesion. Okay? That's not the original intent, but certainly within the capabilities of the technology. There are applications for all of this, for all of this stuff. So just to illustrate that, it is a wonderful thing in the United States, where I'm from, that one can use electronic technology, Facebook and so on, to organize a rally for an in-person rally for Black Lives Matters. That's a wonderful thing to be able to do. It's also a wonderful thing to be able to do to organize a rally for Blue Lives Matters. Okay, the police, support the police. That's a good thing to be able to do too. What's a terrible thing to be able to do is that technology enables you to organize those two rallies for the same time, at the same place, on the same day. That's a terrible thing to happen. And I don't know a technological way of solving that problem. So that's the kind of problem that we deal with. And the last point in my last 40 seconds is to think about the importance of data to everything that we do now. The value of data is increasing. Any place you can use information to advance your goals, to optimize things further, that happens. The volume of data is increasing exponentially. The speed with which it arrives, every one of us is overwhelmed by emails. We need soft, sophisticated software to deal with that. And the truth value in it, the veracity, is is increasingly in question. So that's my perspective on cyberspace, and I turn it back to...
Thank you very much for that, Herb. There's definitely some doom and gloom in your perspectives predictions from the future. I find that a bit disheartening. We might have to come back to you later and get some optimism squeezed out of you somewhere, maybe, possibly. But I appreciate the adherence to the time restrictions. I'll come back to some questions later. Giacomo,
how
about you?
Thank you, and thank you, Herb, for the presentation, because I think we couldn't have staged this any better. I think the title of your slide was, it was all focusing on the complexity of the global digital ecosystem. Then the question might be, how can you navigate that complexity? If you're interested in studying, understanding the future of cybersecurity, and you realize that it's complex and driven by so many different factors, then what approaches, methodologies, and tools can you use to explore and untangle a little bit of this complexity? And that's where the title of our panel, The Foresight, comes in. Futures and foresight methodologies and techniques are not necessarily new per se. They've been around for a while, but for many years they remain somewhat constrained within specific communities of practice, the military being one, but not the only one, or academic communities. And outside of these communities, there was kind of this reputation of those are like fortune tellers, they're just trying to predict the future, and it's not... foresight methodologies hadn't really proven their value to a much broader community. Today, this concept is much more mainstreamed. And I think the biggest part of the problem in relation to futures and foresight was the fact that they were misunderstood and therefore misused for a very long time. First and foremost, futures and foresight isn't just one thing. It's a cluster of different methodologies and approaches that you can use depending on what it is that you're trying to obtain. So first and foremost, defining what it is the question you're trying to answer is key for you to pick on the right approach or the right tool from the foresight toolbox. But first and foremost, I think it's important to understand that foresight is really not about prediction. It's not an exercise of prediction. It's not an exercise that is going to give you answers, at least if you're using it at a strategic level. Strategic foresight is going to be able to, it's going to empower you to ask better questions and more informed questions, and then to stress test your skills, your policies, your standard operating procedures, your assumptions against various possible or plausible futures that you may have conceived. I think it's all about increasing preparedness more than coming up with the one prediction of the future, which most likely, if you're going to try to predict the future, most likely you're going to fail. And it doesn't, of course, it really depends on how far your time horizon is. There is a limit to how much you can use kind of statistical extrapolation of trends to try to predict the future. And when you can do that, when you can do that kind of trend analysis, it's somewhat useful if you're going back to Herb's slide. If you take individual bullets on that slide, maybe you can try to map or to predict conduct some form of trend analysis for each one of those things individually. But the future isn't that easy. All of those things interact with each other. And sometimes we need methodologies that allow us to not only look at each one of these things individually, but also what is going to be the interplay between them. What kind of impact will evolution of new technologies have on behaviors of individuals, and how would that behavior in individuals at the same time impact social cohesion, for example. and the way in which communities are created and people interact with each other, and what kind of impact will technology have on the attack surface, etc. So all of these kind of factors become entangled with each other, and you kind of need some form of tools that allow you to explore that. And that's where futures and foresight becomes very, very useful. And if you think about the future of, you know, cyberspace, it is very important to understand that the future of cyberspace, yes, will depend on cyber, but it's also going to depend on a number of factors that have directly nothing to do with cyber itself, but will ultimately shape the way in which societies, people, governments, and businesses will use technology. And that will have kind of an impact on the cybersecurity landscape. Again, Herb mentioned COVID. Think about our understanding of what cybersecurity was before COVID, and then after COVID. The technology was already there. There was nothing necessarily new from a technological breakthrough perspective. It just became way more diffused than it used to be in a matter of months. So we saw in months a digital transformation that experts had predicted would take years. And then something like COVID came in, and suddenly all of those timelines were constrained, and we as a society and as a technical community were not necessarily ready to keep up with the pace of digital transformation. So all of these factors, I think, are important to consider. And if we think about the cybersecurity futures, I think there are, you know, a variety of socio-technical factors that we need to consider. Herb, again, already mentioned quite a few. From a technological perspective, I want to highlight a few that I think we should keep an eye on and potentially discuss when we open the floor. The future of connectivity in terms of the connectivity infrastructure. 5G seems already a thing of the past. Now we're exploring 6G, et cetera, and what is going to come next? So the increased connectivity, what is going to be the impact of that? Artificial intelligence, of course, is important. Quantum, we are starting, you know, when I started my job at Unity 5 years ago, experts were saying we're 10 years, 15 years away from, you know, quantum becoming a thing. And now 5 years have passed. So we are, you know, that time is approaching. And if half of what we hear about quantum is going to be true, that's definitely going to be a concern for a lot of people in this room and beyond. And then, of course, the convergence of all of these technologies. You know, if we think about the smartphone in itself was a disruptive innovation, but it was enabled because the individual technologies that are part of a smartphone reached a level of maturity that allowed them to be combined into a single device. If you think about digital cameras, computing power, you know, connectivity infrastructure and networks, etc., memory, size of processors, etc. So keeping track of how all of these technologies individually are progressing is important, but it's also important to keep an eye on how are they going to converge together and potentially create something new. Geopolitics are going to be key in terms of not only relationships between states, but also how these relationships are going to influence things, for example, like supply chains. And, you know, those are going to have really important impact, regulation, global, regional regulation, and also strategic choices. We see how states are starting to become increasingly concerned over their ability to be strategically independent from others, or at least contain the dependence within certain groups of allied. So keeping track of all of these trends is going to be very important as we look at the future. And I think I have only 10 seconds left. So what I'm going to say is I'm going to leave you with one important concept, which is related to the issue of connectivity. A few years ago, after everyone was talking about Internet of Things and the kind of explosion of connected devices, I heard one expert said something that really stuck in my mind, which is, yes, it's important, Internet of Things, but let's not forget the Internet of Forgotten Things. So those are going to be all of those devices that are connected to the internet that nobody remembers of or forgets about, because they are replaced by new technology, more modern technologies. They're not patched. They create new vulnerabilities. The smart fridge or the smart AC control system that is installed in this hotel in 20 years maybe hasn't been patched, but it's still an active connected device that nobody remembers about. So the Internet of Forgotten Things, I think, is one of the most pressing issue for us to look about, to think about.
Thank you very much, Giacomo. That's, again, with the doom and the gloom on the vulnerabilities of the future. I find this quite concerning when you combine your data volume and velocity with your models, and suddenly you won't just be predicting the past, but actually predicting the future. It's quite a concerning thought. With that, Chris, do you have anything? Do you have any good news for us?
No, I don't have any good news. Yeah. And if somebody, one of you cyber folks, can hack into the AC control system and turn down the temperature, it'd be great. There's some seats down here, by the way. Ingrid wants us to be casual. Now, you can't start the timer before I start.
Be nice, on, reset man. The timer for him. I've been so strict with them.
All right. Thanks for having me. This is my first SciCon, my first time in Tallinn. It's beautiful. I appreciate the opportunity to come in. What I was asked to talk about is how MITRE thinks about the future. Not what MITRE thinks about the future, but how we think about it. It's a little bit going to be a little bit more process-oriented, a little bit more structure-oriented. Bear with me. We need to get ideas out there for the conversation. In the realm of cybersecurity, I think that actually MITRE is more well known for cataloging the past and preparing capabilities than predicting the future. You've probably heard of MITRE Attack, MITRE Defend, Caldera. It's really widely adopted in the US. But we do spend a great deal of time thinking about what comes next. We use structured thinking like strategic foresight. We're also, and this is something we could probably talk about later, starting to invest really heavily in immersive environments, digital twins, hardware-in-the-loop simulations, those kinds of tools, both to look at different possible future states, but as importantly, sometimes maybe more importantly, if you can visualize that sort of stuff for policymakers, for decision makers in government, it's really impactful. And so we believe strongly in those sorts of digital tools. I'm not going to talk about the strategic foresight. I'm going to go in a little bit of a different direction here, a little bit of education. I think you'll get my point by the end. And what I want to do instead is highlight maybe a less obvious factor that impacts the effectiveness of prediction, of foresight. I hope that we can all agree that it's impossible to explore future states in isolation. A huge part of MITRE's success in this space is because of our intentionally designed role as an independent, trusted connector between government, the commercial sector, and academia, these three critical elements of a cybersecurity universe. And here's a little bit of the education part. The basic, as I think it's, we have a lot of government officials here from different countries. The basis of this role is a special class of organizations chartered by U.S. agencies, and we call them Federally Funded Research and Development Centers, or FFRDCs, and they share some key features. One is they're nonprofit, non-commercial entities. They're explicitly proscribed from competing with industry. They're closely intertwined with government. They sit next to government. They help government make decisions. They have access to special government information. And generally deep technical expertise and close but conflict of interest free relationships with academia and close but conflict of interest free relationships with the private sector. And these FFRDCs are designed to solve problems that the government and academia can't and that the private sector won't. Government often doesn't have cutting edge expertise, can't afford it, can't find it, can't convince them to work for the government. Academia generally doesn't have the skills to scale solutions, and industry is not going to do something where they can't make a profit. So the FFRDCs address problems like predicting and understanding the future. This is something that, you know, people don't get paid a lot to do, as interesting as it is. Prototyping and testing solutions, and particularly high-risk solutions, you know, taking flyers on new ideas, and serving as organizing nodes for public-private partnerships. And the essential reason that these FFRDCs work well is trust. Trust that they act on behalf of the government and society solely. trust that they won't betray intellectual property, trust to handle, analyze, and share sensitive data, share what people want to share, don't share what they don't, but squeeze the goodness out of those data, and trust that they're not selling things to the government. There's not a commercial interest, and this is really important. The government and industry and academia all understand that these FFRDC entities are successful when they help academia and industry serve government better. All right, so that's a little bit of background. MITRE, the company that I work for, we happen to operate the Cybersecurity Federally Funded Research and Development Center for the US government. So we're developing capabilities, we're helping them with standards, we're sort of doing the routine work. But the reason that MITRE as an organization is so successful in solutions for now and for anticipating the future in cybersecurity, it's not because we run a cyber FFRDC, and it's not because we're good at strategic foresight or virtual reality modeling and so forth. It turns out that our superpower is actually because we run six of these entities. And this is sort of the point I want to make. MITRE runs our federal government's Treasury and Commerce FFRDC. So we're involved with the technical aspects of banking intermediation. We're involved in digital currencies, et cetera. We run our Health and Human Services FFRDC for our federal government. So we're involved in digital medicine, both on the provider side and on the billing and operational side. We run our transportation FFRDC. So we're involved in aviation, we're involved in autonomous vehicles, we're involved in smart cities. We run our homeland security, and this is repetitive, but I'm getting to a point. We run our Homeland Security FFRDC. Our Department of Homeland Security is responsible for critical infrastructure. And of course we run, maybe more famously, our Defense and Intelligence FFRDC. So we're working in cybersecurity, but we're also deeply involved in all of these technologies that are directly impacted increasingly by cybersecurity as this technology moves faster. Look, I'm proud of what we do at MITRE. I'm talking a lot about MITRE. I'm not here to sell MITRE. I'm presenting MITRE, this idea, as an example. The nations in NATO can follow this example and copy it. NATO itself can follow this example. This organization that's sponsoring the conference here, I always have to write it down, the CCDCOE, say that 10 times fast, is beautiful. I mean, it's a wonderful construct. My question is it connected to these other technologies in a way that provides the insight necessary to really think about the future of the cyber-physical, cybersecurity interactions with these other technologies? I'd argue that cybersecurity and the future of cybersecurity or the internet cannot exist in the minds of folks really just focused on that. This connectivity is important. So the question for the discussion is this group, is NATO, is the CCDCOE structured in a way that lets it access the deep technical insight into these other technologies? And I think that's an essential piece of predicting the future. So thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Chris, and thank you for the challenge to the audience. I might suffer from a hint of selective hearing, but what I heard was a little bit of optimism that there is enough trust between government and this not-for-profit organization doing some sort of work that is actually valuable to society without trying to sell it and without competing with anyone.
Well, there's a way to be the glue and there's a way to be the grease and still provide a wonderful space for the private sector to do their thing and make lots of money.
But as you say, it requires trust. So that's fantastic. And that might be the highlight of today, actually, hearing a hint of trust. Hopefully not. Hopefully we'll get some more from the audience eventually. Our last speaker, Ludovic, he actually has a multimedia presentation for you guys, so get excited. Floor is yours.
Thank you. First of all, I'm not a cyber specialist, for the record. I'm not even an engineer myself, so that's probably why I'm here in front of you today. First, let's start with the compulsory corporate slide because, well, it's compulsory, at least for me. It's a quick introduction to the DGA that has been founded by General de Gaulle over 60 years ago, and that enabled France to rank among the world's leading nations in terms of defense and technological expertise, management of complex projects, cooperation, and exports. Its perimeters and its capabilities made it a unique entity across the world, to the extent that until today we are not even able to translate it in English. We don't really have any other counterpart in the world, maybe because we are a big part of the nuclear deterrent, for example, which is really sensitive. You can find here some of the redefined mission that shows that today more than ever anticipation is key. It is key to avoid strategic surprise in science and technology. It means we need to anticipate this impact in terms of both threat and opportunities. This is for our defense system. In order to do that, so actually I was asked to introduce you to a program led by DGA that is called Red Team Defense. We use immersive tools. We use fiction as one of our main tools. It's not a gimmick. Actually, it's our goal is more to surprise and challenge the decision makers, because everything we believe regarding anticipation or foresight is about decision making. So the Red Team program, it was composed of science fiction authors and script writers working together closely with scientific and military experts. So this is very innovative, especially in the French military culture. Its mission was ambitious, as the goal was to imagine some threats that could directly endanger French interests. In particular, it anticipated technological, economic, societal, and environmental aspects as well of the future that could generate potential conflicts by 2030 to 2060, which is quite the long range. Part of the program has been classified, but mainly we have studies that have been made public, and we also publish, for example, a best-selling book. You can find all that information online easily. Yes. So, leaving long-term horizon, because 2060 is not for tomorrow, it is essential for us, because we really need, as the Ministry of Armed Forces, to work closely with operators. So, the shorter and medium-term range is very important for decision-making and to adapt quickly. This is why we have launched an anticipation program that is called Combat Horizon. It covers 6 months to 10 years time range, which is which actually didn't exist before. This is Combat Horizon. We call it a NES assessment program. We don't have NES assessment capability per se in France, but this is, I'd say, the first step in order to create this this capacity. In the interest of all sectors of the French government, by enabling it to look beyond programming cycles and to transform uncertainty into opportunity. Anticipation is about visualize opportunities. This is really important. So to illustrate our approach and give you a better understanding of our method, I'm going to share a recent study on a hot topic with high strategic stakes, which are the Olympic Games. As you know, France is going to host the 2024 Olympic Games this summer, and this event represents a major opening for cyber actions with a wide range of motivations, from greed to militancy, espionage, information, warfare, you name it. And in order to further stress test the cybersecurity strategy of the Olympic Games, the French MOD initiated a study that is quite disruptive regarding cyber threats. It means to strengthen the cybersecurity by providing a fresh and disruptive outlook on the existing measure, and especially by trying to detect some blind spots that the specialists didn't actually identify. So we are happy to seize this SciCon's opportunity to share a quick video associated to one of the scenarios that we have done.
De Timothée Latour, qui m'a dit qu'une place pour la cérémonie d'ouverture des JO, ça pouvait t'intéresser. Moi, malheureusement, j'ai un empêchement, donc je pourrais pas y aller. Je suis un petit peu deg parce que c'est une place de catégorie A. Il m'a dit que tu habitais du côté de la Motte-Piquet, donc autant faire un heureux. Je te partage un lien vers le billet. Reviens vers moi rapidement si ça t'intéresse, sinon j'en ferai profiter quelqu'un d'autre. Voilà. Je vous souhaite une bonne journée et à bientôt. Ciao Clément. Salut Joséphine, je te contacte de la part de Sophie Balu, qui m'a dit qu'une place pour la cérémonie d'ouverture des JO, ça pouvait t'intéresser. Moi, malheureusement, je pourrais pas y aller parce que j'ai un empêchement. En plus, c'est une place de catégorie A, donc je suis un petit peu deg. Told me that you live near Palais Royal, so if I can make someone happy, je t'envoie un lien vers le billet. Dime rapido si estás interesado. Sinon, je le ferai partager à quelqu'un d'autre. Une belle journée, Kim, et je te dis à bientôt. Ciao. So unfortunately, my time is up. I have to finish with this video. I have many other things. It's kind of frustrating to share with you. Some of you might have recognized the tool that is used in this video, that is a Flipper Zero. It's actually available for 200 euros on Amazon. It's banned in certain countries. We are maybe looking for banning it before the Olympics in France. And let's have that kind of discussion for the Q&A, or maybe even later, if you need to chat or if you have interest in what we're doing, we might meet outside by the photo corner after the event. Thank you. Sorry, Ingrid, for
Thank
the,
you very much,
the slight Ludwig. Delay.
You're forgiven, and I hope the audience will make sure to ask you questions that allows you more time to talk about the things I know you're very interested in. I like how you brought in the threat of the buzz that Herb was touching upon, how we have to protect ourselves from the notifications of our own phone, be it for ads for new shoes or a deal that is simply a little bit too good. On that note, we're going to take a momentary break, and I'm going to invite everyone to get up, because we are the session after lunch, and everyone's a bit sleepy. So we're basically doing a seventh inning stretch. I will spare you the song unless someone really feels like singing. And I'm going to invite everyone to look a little bit silly and do this. Very nice, very nice.
Yeah. Is this
the least silly of us?
This is recorded, right?
Oh, yeah, this will be on YouTube. But don't worry, it's mostly us. On that note, I hope we're all feeling a bit refreshed. I know it's not very warm. We'll just be glad we're not in room three, goodness. And with that, we have two volunteers out here. One's over here, and we have another one back here. They have microphones for you. Again, strict rules, please introduce yourselves. You know way too much about these guys already, so I'm sure they'll appreciate you returning the favor. Don't be afraid to ask questions on anything they've touched upon, or even your own visions for the future, your own predictions, your own fears. Low threshold, no such thing as a stupid question, and no such thing as a stupid answer, today at least.
We can try.
We can try. Excellent. Spotted you already in the back, familiar face from that can introduce himself. Go ahead.
Test.
Get us going.
So Josh Gold now with NATO HQ Cyber Threat Analyst. Thanks to everyone for the talk, and thanks for the video and the stretch. My question maybe focuses more on this one word, visions, particularly, and Professor Lin touched on this, but most of us here are from countries or are in countries that have certain fundamental values that we stay true to as we promote our interests in cyberspace and do things that are cybery, whether that's to promote national power or secure things. But what, to all the panelists, what are the key cyberspace issues in which we are made most vulnerable because we stick to these values? And where do these, in what areas do our values make us stronger or more resilient? Thanks.
The value of values, I like it. Thank you also for really bastardizing the word cyber that I hate so much and just made it cybery. Beautiful, well done. Thank you for that. Does anyone feel called to answer his call to values? Herb,
sure.
Let her rip.
You ask for examples of places where our values can be, in some sense, used against us. Let me give you two examples of that. I mentioned one in the beginning, the value of connectivity. Increasing connectivity to everybody is a good thing in some ways because it enables you to connect to everybody, but it also connectivity also enables everybody else to connect to you, and this is a situation in which connectivity cuts both ways. And do we benefit more or are we harmed more by essentially unlimited and unimpeded connectivity? Second example of that of this is the value of free expression, free speech. Most countries, most democratic countries, have some traditions of free speech. Normally a very, very good thing. But we have seen the whole point of it, the reason that information operations are so successful against us is that the bad guys have weaponized free speech against us. When you try to shut it down, there are claims of suppression of free speech and so on. And those claims are very, very hard to deal with. So you see situations in which the value that you're trying to uphold is itself a weapon against you. It used to be there were offsetting, that you had an advantage and disadvantage in one area and an advantage in another area. And you could argue that they offset each other. But if you increase connectivity, you increase it for the good guys and you increase it for the bad guys. If you increase free speech protections, you increase it for the good guys, you increase it for the bad guys. And they're no longer, you know, offsetting things. They're the same thing. And figuring out how to manage that is going to be increasingly difficult, in my view.
Mm-hmm. So essentially, we've written down the rules that we've decided to play by, and that's provided malicious actors with a playbook for how to bring us down. This came up quite a bit. Also, for those of you who were there during the cyber-enabled election interference workshop back on day zero, which seems like a very long time ago, several of you, I see a couple of you in the crowd at least, the continued response was misinformation campaigns using freedom of expression, using freedom of connectivity, to keep pounding out messages that create not necessarily one specific scenario, but just constant uncertainty in the very nature of truth, so to speak. Giacomo, do you have anything you'd like to share on this?
No, I would just double down on what Herb say here said, because I think there is this kind of a... it's not, it shouldn't be perceived as a trade-off, but in many ways it is between, you know, how far do we stick to the values of, you know, that we stand for, human rights, we protect human rights, and on the other hand, the security side, right? So depending, I think Herb had in his slide, correct me if I'm wrong, but you had a side that said something about different approaches to authoritarian regimes and non-authoritarian regimes, and how more authoritarian regimes might be, in some cases, an advantage here, because they put their security perhaps at a higher point than human rights, etc. But I should say that, you know, within the UN context, there is this framework of responsible state behavior in cyberspace that all states in the General Assembly, by consensus, agreed to kind of apply. And among the norms, there is a norm that said that states, you know, should use their ICT's capacities in respect of human rights. So there is this kind of a clear tension. I'm not necessarily going to say that there is, again, a trade-off, but it's definitely, very much in agreement with what Herb said here, is that we cannot say that human rights are important only when it's convenient to us.
Absolutely. Right? Ludovic, when you have this conversation, when you talk about banning this thing that's potentially dangerous, is this the kind of conversation you're having?
Definitely. Ethics, resilience, all that stuff is very important. But what I would like to emphasize is that at some point we do have a vision that is very techno-centered all the time. And we know better how our phones are functioning than our brains. We don't know really how where is our threshold, where is our cognitive threshold. And nowadays, everyone, even decision-making people, are victims of this infobesity. And all this, you need to take some distance at some point, and to be able how we can cope with such issues that are thrown to us by our competitors. This is why cognitive warfare is actually also something we are very, very interested in.
And certainly concerning, considering what the next generation is being exposed to from a very young age. Chris, would you like to add anything to this?
Well, I guess I'd sort of flip the question. How has, sort of where you're going maybe, how has the evolution of cyberspace changed our values? I mean, I don't, come from a different generation. I met my wife the old-fashioned way, you know, I don't share... on social media and et cetera. And my kids think very differently than I do. And so in the spirit of foresight, I wonder if we could ask, where is this going? How will our values continue to evolve as a result of the tools and the connectivity?
Can we protect ourselves against weaponization of social media targeting essentially kids without losing our own values? Anyone? Thoughts?
Say that again.
Do we have to compromise our own values in order to protect ourselves in this domain?
No.
Sorry, I promised not to use the moderator's privilege too much.
We shouldn't, otherwise we've left the war, the cognitive war.
Okay? Yeah.
So this is a long-term preparation for media, of course, media literacy, and all that things that have been identified. But it's a long-term for next generation to be more aware. And yeah. I'm pretty optimistic that your kids, my kids, the next generation, they go through some dark paths, but they have the resources to understand. Mainly, we are more, us the boomers, the victims of that kind of attacks. It might, maybe social media are part of the solution as well, who knows?
Yeah, who's to say what the right value set is? I mean, historically, we've had all sorts of different kinds of values that, you know, maybe turned out to be things we don't celebrate now. So, who knows?
Sure. Certainly not a static question, by all means. Yeah. I think with that, I'll turn back to the audience. I'm sure we have more questions out there. If not, there's going to be some cold calling. Please.
Matthias Krempel, German Cyber Reserve, and my question goes directly to Monsieur Schacker and is about the tool you presented. I had the honor to experience it 2 years ago in Paris, and it impressed me pretty much. That was the one thing, but I watched the senior government officials present in the audience, French government in the audience, and I experienced that they were pretty much hesitant and they didn't like it too much. So things, could you comment on how things change? And eventually I conclude my question with the statement of the French author, a French author who said, Labiche, how far can you go too far when you explore this future things in presenting it to people?
Yes, thank you for the question. Actually, the aim of such program is to keep our leaders awake at night. So I think it's pretty successful according to your experience. This is one thing. And it was like that at the beginning. And not only the decision maker, but political level, but also military level. It was a little bit far from what they were used to, but it was the initial intent. But then it became popular. It became very popular. And once it was popular, every leader was embracing, you know, the program and saying, the red team, the red team. And so what we have done, we killed the program. Once it was so successful because it was an experiment, we killed it. So now we are preparing the next step, because this was just an experiment, lasted 3 years. It did have very good, very interesting feedback. We are still working on these lessons learned, but we are using it to do something way more ambitious and way more inclusive.
I noticed in your development towards your team reminded me of the idea that led to the tank 100-odd years ago, started with a conception drawing, a sci-fi book that inspired and kept leaders up at night and led to a rather significant investment project. Anyone like to add on this, or should we turn back to the audience? Yeah? Okay. Let's see. We'll start in the far corner and work our way, and we have three questions here.
Thank you very much for a great panel on unique moderating. My name is Ricardo Junce, coming from the Montenegrin government cert. And during the conference, we discussed various types of threats and vulnerabilities. Particularly, I'm interested in hearing opinions on the future of our SCADA systems, given their known vulnerabilities and their critical role in our infrastructure. How do you foresee their evolution and measures needed to secure them for the future? Thank you.
So the questions on the future of SCADA systems and our ability, and our ability to, I assume, patch them, keep them up to date, and not let them be this internet formerly connected part or still connected things of the past. Anyone feel called to have some thoughts on this, Herb?
If you're asking, do we have the capability to secure them better in the future? Absolutely. We have lots of capability. Do we have the will to do that? That's a very different question. Mm-hmm. Just as an example, the utility companies and so on, when they put in SCADA systems, they plan for a lifetime of 20 years. 20 years? Before you update information technology? That doesn't compute to me, okay? By the way, this is true of militaries too. They expect their systems to last for 20 years. They 30 years. They don't plan for the electronics to last that long. They know better than that. But it's still the same fundamental architecture. I mean, 20 years? It's a question of will. Do you want to plan for updates on a 5-year cycle? You could, but that gets very expensive. Who's going to pay?
Ludwig, anything to add?
Yes, the number of critical infrastructures are increasing by the day. And they are increasing and are not completely state-sponsored or controlled by states anymore. So it means, for example, let's take the space domain. We used to be pretty safe out there. You know, it was the Russian, it was military, it was completely sovereign. But since a few years, now the private sector and, of course, the constellation, my microsatellite constellation and everything, led to emerging threats that we are not completely yet aware of. What about cyber in the space domain? All these issues, all these use cases we are working on, but it's not about the responsibility of the states and of the military. It's more something combined with the civil society and the private sector. This dual use is now very key. So it's important that this cooperation and coordination with all actors is very imbricated. And this is also why, actually, the Ministry of Defense, the French Ministry of Defense, changed its name, because we believe now we are the Ministry of Armed Forces, because we believe that defense is involving pretty much everyone, private citizens as well as companies.
Yeah, all society approach certainly seems like an optimistic way out of this, if that's the best we can do. Any more thoughts before we go to... No, there was a gentleman next to you that I think also had a question, and then we had you in the front row. We'll move through it.
Thank you. I'm Eduard Barbu from University of Tartu. So my question is this, how good were your organization in forecasting the future? So in the past, how good were you to forecast the most disruptive technology today, which are large language models that allow you to create fake videos, allow you to create text and images that are called deep fakes about everything. So I've seen before a scenario, I think it's very unlikely, then a speaker talked about disruption by quantum computing. Again, I don't see this coming in the near future, but how good were you of predicting that this most disruptive technology? Because I worked in this domain for years and I didn't see it coming. So this is my question. Thank you.
Thank you for your question. I think it was directed maybe at Chris's Smitra model. I think it was directed at you, at your models.
I don't know. I'll answer the question.
Or was it more on a policy level? Ability to predict these changes. So specifically, Mitra's attack model.
I've seen that all of you have models to predict, to forecast the disruptive technologies in the future, right? You talk about the threats in the future, cyber threats. So the question was, how good were you to predict, to forecast these disruptive technologies that are large language models that allow you to make deep fakes and so on?
So success rate of each of your models and each of your patterns, each of your approaches to this field in predicting large language models, development of AI, deep fakes, social media videos of fake people that look very real and the likes. I'll start over here with Ludovic and can move down the line. How about that? Mm-hmm.
Yes, I'm pretty happy to tell you that I am at 100% success.
But fantastic, the French have solved it.
This is true, because I'm only 6 months old, first of all. But then, what is really interesting in your question is that, first of all, we don't predict, okay? What we do, we are trying to anticipate. We're not even saying that we are anticipating. We are trying to anticipate. We have a new slogan that is, if you want peace, prepare future. What is really interesting is that you are maybe a quantum specialist, so you are very much, you have this expertise. I will never have this expertise myself, for sure. But what I can do is to find or imagine use cases that will combine some of your expertise with another technology that is already there. We are not, I'm not looking necessarily at to tomorrow's breakthrough. We were talking about cognitive warfare. I'm already trying to see how biotech can, with hyperconnectivity, can mixed with some neuroscience, can lead to very awful results. This is already what we are trying to do. And once we've done that by ideation and creativity, we put some seed inside the mind of our leaders. So it's there. And when it comes up, when something comes up, you know, it will be less a strategic surprise. Actually, our slogan, our logo is a black swan. So what we are trying to do is to change black swans in what we call in French, vilain petit canard, ugly little ducks.
Somewhat of a comforting answer, I think. Chris, your two cents, please.
Well, gosh, when it comes to AI, I would say we were so good at predicting it that we were seriously working on AI already in the 50s, you know, two or three, depending on you count it, AI winters ago. And for sure, we understood from the technical community that large language models were coming. We had people working on them, but still we were caught by surprise by the speed with which this is being adopted. And along with that, the incredible diversity of use cases for it. So I guess the message there is you can know it's coming and still not, you know, still be, you know, caught with your pants down, so to speak.
And yeah, and if, you know, I started my briefing by saying that foresight is not about making predictions. So this I would agree with others, because the moment you try, you're most likely going to fail. But if we take, for example, the case of AI, the sort of approaches and models that we would use wouldn't necessarily question if AI happens or it doesn't happen, but we will try to plug in questions such as, what if artificial general intelligence lands earlier than planned? What if it takes longer than planned? What if it comes right when there seems to be consensus among the technical experts, which we're not, that it's going to be the same with quantum and others? If you're looking at specific technologies, we're trying to do some sort of sensitivity analysis that helps us understand how prepared would governments or societies, or depending who is the interlocutor we're dealing with, be to deal with potential disruptive effects introduced by technologies if they were to land before or after when there seems to be agreement. And even if you look at something like artificial general intelligence, the time horizon of when that is going to become a thing, first of all, every AI expert is going to have a different opinion on it, so who do you trust? It's the first thing. But if you average it out, it seems like it's getting, you know, closer and closer. So we'll see how that plays out. But I don't think there is such a thing as a success rate, simply because, at least in the exercises I've been involved, we were never being asked to make a prediction. And that's the whole point.
It's one way of safeguarding yourself against being wrong. Don't make a prediction. Good advice, that. Herb.
So I think you told me that I had a pretty gloomy view of the future, and I think our commentators asked me, how can I make it more gloomy? are there going to be additional surprises in the future? Absolutely. Will there be things that we can't anticipate? Absolutely. But by definition, what those things will do, if they are significant, is that they will disrupt existing understandings. Okay. And those existing understandings of the world that we live in are political and sociological and so on, organizational. You can be absolutely sure that the new technology is going to disrupt existing agreements, precedents, traditions, and so on that have been developed around the old set of technologies. And that's going to be disruptive to society. That's what a disruptive technology does by definition. And we're seeing this with AI now. Yes, there are a lot of people who have speculated about which way things are going to go and you know, various timelines and so on, but none of them have had to actually face the prospect that the time is now. Mm. And you look at what exists out in the world, the compromises that we make with any existing set of technologies is extensive. Yeah. And it takes a long time to arrive at that kind of a consensus and those kinds of compromises. Disruptive technologies, by definition, are going to change all of that and throw us all into chaos again.
It's a great question.
If I may add a thought on that, I find it interesting also that the technology doesn't have to be perfect to be disruptive.
Correct.
You can have a photo with seven fingers and half an ear, and it's still interesting. It's still going to have an effect. So maybe when they were making these predictions in the 50s, they might have envisioned a more perfect technology doing incredible things. And it turns out if you're halfway there, you can still have huge impact without necessarily being violent, just the cognitive warfare that is a constant concern. I'm abusing my privilege here. We had a question on the front row.
Thank you. Max Pavlyuk, I'm for Soviet Ukraine cyber component. Well, first and foremost, let me just take an opportunity and express appreciation of the common support that given by our partner nations to the fight that we are conducting against the adversary. So on behalf of the people of Ukraine, my brothers and sisters in arms, thank you very much indeed. Appreciate the help. And with that, I've got a question. So during the war we are facing in Ukraine, our partner nations, things got there, they're helping us with a different assistance in terms of weapons and ammunition. They even created the coalitions of offensive components like coalition of tanks, coalition of F-16s, etc. So my question is that, what do you think would stop our partner nations from the creation, the coalition of the cyber offensive? The second question is, if so, should we anticipate this kind of coalition in a visible future? And looking on the topic of our panel, which is a future foresight, what is your thoughts whether it could be a game changer in our war if created? Thank you.
Thank you for your question. I think we might go to our government representative first here. What is preventing a coalition of cyber offensive forces on the same level as providing physical weapons in Ukraine? I realize this is also a very political question, so I don't want to push anyone to answer this outside their field, but if anyone would like to share thoughts on this, you're more welcome to.
First of all, we have so many things to learn from what's going on the Ukrainian battlefield. I was talking with the director of the center early this morning regarding electronic warfare. For example, the best in the world are the Russians and the Ukrainians. Same with many, many countermeasures, as well as cyber, the IT...
mechanism and all about the defensive component. My question was regarding the offensive capability, like, as I mentioned, tanks and airplanes. Sorry for that.
It's a very interesting question.
Let me take a stab at that. I think it's less likely, okay, to have a coalition of national partners who put together cyber offensive. The reason for that is that effective cyber offense requires extraordinarily good intelligence. If it doesn't, then you can just farm it out and anybody can do it. And you don't need the coalition. But good cyber offense conducted at the national level, what they bring to the battle is good intelligence. And what you're proposing in a coalition is that essentially you're going to have to share a lot of intelligence. That's more difficult. That's why I think it's less likely.
The Ukrainian cyber army is already doing quite a good job. You know, this civil society hacker components. I completely agree with what Herbs is saying. Every day, on everyday basis, I'm trying to support President Macron's will to make French people understand what is economy of war. Because we are in some kind of war. We are at least maybe in an unpeace, like we said this morning, domain. But the French society doesn't feel at war, and the French, some French services, it's already really difficult for us to lead offensive cyber actions as long as we are not ourselves, we are not considering ourselves to be at war. It's kind of difficult, especially with that kind of domain that is very sovereign and we are not exchanging between NATO partners. So it is unlikely, for sure. But bilateral and support in other kind of, exactly what I was saying, you know, combining technology or use cases,
This is already ongoing, and for sure it will increase.
Thank you very much for your question. You have the support of this community in your ongoing struggles. With that, we're going to move on to our next question. Please, front row again.
Hello, I'm Karen Gutierrez from the Army Cyber Institute. That's at West Point, the U.S. Military Academy. I have a question that's related, and it's about what is the strategy in the strategic foresight methodology? You think about strategy as relying upon the moves and counter moves of an opponent. You think about it perhaps as positioning you for advantage in the next play. Advantage for whom and to what end?
Thank you for your question. So strategy and methodology, does your model fit strategy? Giacomo,
I can try to give you a stab. I think that I've run a few of these strategic foresight exercises for different organizations and partners, etc. And the answer to your question would be different on each of these cases. I think strategic foresight gives you, as I said, a methodology, a toolbox, an approach. But then the first question that actually determines success or failure of the whole exercise is the ability to design the right questions you're trying to answer. So I think the qualifier of strategic foresight versus other types of foresight stands to signify the level at which you are kind of, it's the problem statement. It's a way of showcasing the level of entanglement and the intricacy that it may exist between all the different factors, if you go back to Herb's first slide. So you're not doing foresight to predict or to anticipate the trajectory of one specific factor you might be interested in. That can be, it can be something very at the tactical level. You're focusing more on the entanglement about different actors and different factors. So to answer your question, strategy for who? I don't want to sound like it always gives the answer, it depends. But it really it really depends. Like, what is it that you want to achieve? What is it that you're trying to look at? For me, strategic foresight and methodologies are particularly useful for big systemic level questions, such as you're interested in looking at, I don't know, the future of land warfare, for example. It's a big question that will have many determinants in it, and strategic foresight may allow you to give structure in trying to answer a question that otherwise would be basically open-ended.
So value and tailoring. Ludwig, please.
This is a very interesting question, actually, because methodology is very important. What is even more important is to get rid of the tools and to get rid of the methodology at some point. Because I'm pretty new in this foresight environment, but what I've seen by benchmarking is that there is a bunch of experts figuring out new tools and matrices, and it's very well conceptualized, but they are in loop. They're staying in a loop, some kind of methodological loop. They love it. They love what they are doing, and they are producing tools and very complex matrix. But then foresight or anticipation had to be of service for the battlefield, for operations, for the armed forces. So this is why we are not a completely, a small cell that is just thinking by themselves, but we are working closely with the actors, the operators themselves, and we are tailor building. We are making tailor-made programs, co-constructing with them. We don't have something on the shelf that we just put on the field. We co-build with people, what they need. They express their need, and we work with them with their expertise in order to anticipate. Because once you anticipate, you will see opportunities. Whether it's from the political decision makers up to the artillery platoon guy.
Thank you for that. And again, adding on that tailoring aspect, we've thrown up another Mentimeter for you, and it's working very well, as we can see. So over here on your left, we have the answers from before we started this panel. We have about just short of 9 minutes left. I'm going to ask you to use the Mentimeter code on this side. And especially if you voted before, really any either way, after this panel, same statement, absolutely or no way. So feel free to keep voting. We'll try not to get too distracted by it while we take the last couple of questions, and then I'll reserve the last 2 or 3 minutes. I have one question for each of you, and I'll wrap up and get out of here. All right, anyone else, please?
Kyonel Vitaly Zhukov, Armed Forces of Ukraine. So my question is about cyber deterrence. We have been discussing a lot this matter about during different conferences, including this one. And so far, as far as I heard, the main way for cyber deterrence is creation strong cyber defensive capabilities. How do you think, what are the ways, policies, and means for cyber deterrence in future?
It's a very interesting question. Anyone on the panel feel? So the question is, the future of cyber deterrence, is it in defense or in other means? Ludovic, you looked very eager.
Yes, as a non-expert in cyber, I can tell, I really can tell, you know, bluntly what I think. First of all, deterrence is something that a French official will never tolerate if it's not linked to nuclear. So I'm putting that here because it's some debate we have internally that are very, very funny sometimes. Anyway, so to go back to your question, I believe that cyber is only a tool. So it must be part of an arsenal of weapons that you could use depending on the effect that you want to attend. It's cyber by itself doesn't exist. It actually doesn't mean anything in my mind. It is just a tool. I'm probably provoking pretty much everyone in the room, but we should widen our horizons. And cyber is one of the tools, but not the only one, whether it's from defense or offense. It's most of the time at the end of the, I'd say, of the cannon, for what I understand.
Giacomo, please.
Yeah, no, it's a very interesting question, and one that we've been looking at the institute where I work. And the reason is that, you know, traditional deterrence, so not in the cyber domain, is predicated on knowing the capability of your adversary and what would be the cost of doing something, right? It's the deterrence element. There is an element of knowledge and transparency involved. In cyber, it's that paradigm is shifted. So the strategic advantage of cyber comes from the ambiguity and the uncertainty that your adversary has over what your capabilities are. So in that respect, I see the argument for framing cyber deterrence as it relates to defensive capabilities more than offensive capabilities, because those are very unlikely to be disclosed. The moment you show your hand in cyber, that's it. You lose the advantage of having it. So there might be something there to explore, for sure.
Absolutely. So strengthen defense over time, unless, of course, we have to look out for a French cyber nuclear bomb. This is okay. You're not working on this.
No, but
that's a good poker face.
Maybe to add something about this question, I was just in the Center of Excellence in Helsinki a few days ago, related to hybrid threats. Hybrid is very interesting. I know it's a NATO concept. It's well studied, but it's well studied by us because it's a Western concept, actually, and we will never do hybrid. Nobody in NATO or in nation countries will say, oh, now I will plan an hybrid operation and it will be offensive one. No, never, impossible. But we have to understand how our competitors are working, whether they are from China, India, China, Russia, wherever. The mindset is very different because they are using the tools, and the tools are they are aiming at one effect, one final effect, and they are using all the tools they have in storage. That's it, and we don't, because we are conceptualizing, and we do have our boundaries, which is good. But it's more complex than what. Again, it's about what is the mindset of my opponent, how is it working, and how can I take countermeasures? And it will not be just cyber. That is for sure.
Absolutely. I think, I don't want to speak for the panel, but I think there you'll meet a lot of consensus on that. For the last couple of minutes that we have, Ludovic, you mentioned earlier that your intention was to make sure to keep your decision makers and your politicians awake at night. So I'm going to throw that question to each of you before we round off the panel tonight, and we'll start on this end. Sorry, Herb, I should have given you a heads up on that. Herb, what keeps you up at night? Put you on the spot there, sorry.
Much of what keeps me up at night is what I would call an unwarranted faith in technology.
That was proven today.
My doctorate's from MIT in physics, and people say to me, how can you be a skeptic about technology if you have a doctorate in physics from MIT? And I say, it's because I have that doctorate. I know how this stuff is made. That's why I'm a skeptic about it. I worry about all unwarranted faith in technology. There are three roads to ruin in technology. You know, there are three roads to ruin. Okay, alcohol is the fastest. Sex is the most fun. Technology is by far the most certain. And I try to get that message across to my classes at Stanford University, where the startup capital of the world. It's a hard message to get across. There's a lot of faith in technology that's misplaced.
I hope you all made a note of that. Giacomo, what keeps you up at night?
So the first answer that came to mind was with my kids, but that's not appropriate.
I think that's not for
this panel. I think one recurring thought that I have is the resistance that I see within governments, particularly certain governments, to realize that you cannot really talk about technology and governance of technology without involving technology owners, developers, and managers in the room. I think there is this clash between how we see kind of governance in the kind of 20th century and 21st century. I think it's changing, and yet I see a lot of resistance in recognizing that when you're dealing with these topics, you need industry at the table, you need civil society at the table, you need really, you know, this multi-stakeholder approach shouldn't be just a buzzword, you should actually make
Absolutely.
It, put it in practice.
The challenges of an all-side society approach. Yep, that's pretty worrying. Chris, how about you?
Well, I also have teenagers that literally keep me up at night, but I'm most concerned about the intersection of AI and biology. Mm. This is a profound potential threat. Simple answer, but there
Parker,
you go.
Simple and terrifying again. Ludovic.
Well, I have a 2 years old, and she's literally crawling into my bed by night, so for sure this keeps me awake. But otherwise, I sleep pretty well.
Oh,
because I'm not watching the news. This is no joke. And I don't have social media. And again, this ability to deal with such constant anxiety that is pushed, because this is what sells. It sells to your brains, it sells to your being. They know what they're doing, everyone. And not just our opponents, the private sector as well. I will not name Meta or whoever, but
or whatever.
This is
solid life advice from Ludovic at the end here. I hope you've all gotten some food for thought and maybe some food for nightmares. I'm not sure, or maybe solid advice. We're going to round off by looking at our very scientifically collected data that will hopefully inform your future methodologies. And the polls are in, and we have not changed really any minds. Okay, solid. We're still scared, and the future is bleak. On that note, thank you to the panelists. Thank you. Well done, everyone.